Over time, our bodies have developed internal patterns that sync with our environment. Light patterns during the day and night affect our bodies. In fact, these around-the-clock patterns, called circadian rhythms, guide nearly all of our physiological processes.
All of us have internal biological clocks that are programmed to be in sync with the 24-hour clock that is really related as to the time it takes our planet to rotate once around its axis. And our bodies, over millions of years of evolution, have come up with a system that anticipates these predictable changes in the course of the day.
These circadian rhythms generate around-the-clock 24-hour oscillations in each cell of our bodies and are controlled by the brain. Sleeping, eating, and much more are dependent on these circadian rhythms. But almost all of us live and work dependent on technology to give us day and night. These unnatural patterns can throw off our natural cycles.
In our current world, there are several things that are affecting this. People working the night shift are now eating at times when they're not really programmed to be eating relative to their own biological clocks. And they have a huge increase in diabetes, obesity, metabolic disease, as well as cardiovascular disease and cancer that are related to these things.
What if we were able to get our metabolism in sync with our circadian rhythms? We could potentially control how and when our bodies store fat and metabolize sugar. We'll explore these possibilities on this edition of LabTV News, Diabetes. Today, we are with Dr. Mitch Lazar, Director of the Institutes for Diabetes, Obesity, and Metabolism at the University of Pennsylvania. He and his team are researching the body's circadian rhythms.
One of the main themes of my laboratory is to understand how genetics and the environment work together to cause diabetes in people and in our society, to cause the epidemic of diabetes. There is no doubt that diabetes is a genetic disease. At the same time, we know that the epidemic of diabetes in our society has increased at a rate that is way higher than could possibly be explained by changes in our genes. That's because of the environment. And we all know what those environmental factors are. They're the access to delicious, fattening, inexpensive foods that are so easily available at the same time that we have a sedentary lifestyle. And on top of that, an environment that's filled with light and we're awake at times when our bodies are programmed to be sleeping. There's even a notion that the just exposure to ambient light from overhead lights, from iPhones, from all sorts of devices are giving us a signal that there's light that's affecting our clocks that we weren't programmed for, and that may also be contributing to this increased metabolic dysfunction in our society.
How we metabolize food and drink depend on these circadian rhythms. But is there something that we can do to take control over what has, to date, been out of our control?
The star of the show is a molecule that's called reverb. And most people know that reverb refers to an oscillation or a vibration. And when you think about circadian rhythms, that's rhythmic. So it sounds like we named reverb very logically around the circadian rhythm. But in fact, reverb was a chance discovery trying to understand aspects of thyroid hormone biology. And we recognized that it was not only playing a role related to thyroid hormone biology, but also had this rhythmic nature, was controlling metabolism in a rhythmic nature.
Okay, so we see a big difference here. So I think that the this huge dip that's gone tells us that we can target reverb as even a potential drug target for trying to keep people warmer, but maybe even for helping them to lose weight and to help their diabetes.
The discovery that reverb has the ability to regulate a cell's internal clock and affect metabolic genes is incredible. But in what ways can this help diabetes patients?
The goal is to translate these findings into new and really useful and hopefully groundbreaking therapies for diabetes. Well, there's a couple of things that I think can bring some hope to people as we continue our research. One of them is that many of the drug targets that already exist are not just constant in our body, but actually have a sine wave of ups and downs. And so when we think about treating people with diabetes for many, many years, one of the biggest concerns is the side effects of the drug when a person's on it for so many years. And if you have a drug in your system 24/7, it's more likely to have side effects than if it's given and only present in your body some times of the day. And if it turned out that your target of the drug, in fact, was only needed to be targeted certain times of the day, you can imagine, and this is something we're trying to do, having a situation where the drug is given at times when the drug target is present but not available in the body to cause side effects and toxicities when it's not needed. I would say in the short term, I'm hoping and I'm actually confident that we'll have new ways to think about the problem, maybe new drugs or new timing of drugs to treat these disorders and the circadian basis, the rhythmic basis that we think is contributing to the problem.
Dr. Lazar's research is offering a new way of thinking about the problem of diabetes. His work could have an impact on generations to come, and we look forward to hearing more about his team's success.
By understanding the genetics, understanding how the environment interacts with the genetics, what molecules are involved, and what targets, I think we're well on the way for a breakthrough.
LabTV News Diabetes, going behind the scenes in labs across America to report on the latest peer-reviewed stories. To see more stories, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.